Today on Numerical Methods, I'd like to start with a new section, a new chapter, and we will look at the numerical approximation of finite differences. So we will look at finite differences today. We will look at the numerical approximation of partial derivatives. So numerical approximation of partial derivatives. So far in the lecture, we looked at calculating an expectation. And actually that was related to approximating an integral, the Monte Carlo integration. Also, we were looking at discretizing an SDE. Okay, and today I like to look at calculating a partial derivative. So some function v given, how can I approximate dv by dx? Yeah, so the inverse to the integral. And what I will do later is look at this, so calculate a partial derivative where v of this parameter x, so maybe I call this parameter now theta, yeah, to distinguish it a little bit. So v of theta is an expectation of some random variable where the random variable is actually the result of some stochastic process. So maybe not to confuse it with the time parameter, maybe I should write this here as some parameter, some subscript parameter here, and okay, inside there is the capital T for the time. Okay, so later we will combine all these things. What I'd like to do today is, how can we approximate a partial derivative? And that's really very classical stuff, but there will be a surprise in say a few minutes, yeah, so at the end of the first part, when we look at computer arithmetics again. So given some algorithm, yeah, so actually a computer algorithm that calculates some value capital V, and this value is calculated as a function of some input parameters, so input parameters to my algorithm. So given that, I would like to calculate partial derivatives or directional derivatives with respect to these parameters. So we are interested here in partial or directional derivatives with respect to these parameters. And for this first part, it's actually not of much interest that x is a vector. So we have multiple parameters x1 and xn. So here it's sufficient to consider just a single scalar parameter. So I just consider a function that depends on a single x. And we like to numerically approximate the partial derivative dv by dx. If you consider applications in mathematical finance, well, then V could be some valuation algorithm. So for example, the value of an option. And these parameters could be model parameters like the initial value of the stochastic process or the parameter sigma or whatever. So that's the context for mathematical finance, and these parameters, they can be very different. So here I just have a small list. Yeah, it could be the value of the stock, the initial value of the stock, of a currency exchange rate, of an interest rate, or whatever. So all this stuff from the application is now not of interest to us. Yeah, we just look at the plain question, how can we numerically approximate the partial derivative. Okay, so this is here my program. So we will first have a very short session on the approximation of the first order derivative. We will derive some approximations and expressions for the approximation error. And then I like to conduct a very nice numerical experiment with you. Let's calculate the derivative of exponential x at x equals zero. So you know derivative of exponential x is exponential x. Derivative at zero is just one. So I know the solution should be one. And I would like to calculate this numerically. And there are a few surprises hidden in this numerical experiment. And then in the following sessions, we will look at error estimates again. So let's start. So I assume that we have a smooth function. So there is a function v here of a single parameter x. So I assume it is smooth. Then I can use the Taylor expansion to write down v at x plus h in terms of v of x and derivatives of v of x at this x. So this here is just the Taylor expansion. Okay, so given some value h, I have that v of x plus h is v of x plus then we have v dv by dx times h. So the first order term, d squared v by dx squared times h squared half, so the second order term, and so on. So I have here a polynomial. A polynomial in h, and we have the remainder which contains the derivative of v at a certain unknown xi. So this xi here is in the interval from x to x plus h. So maybe I write here that we have some h, some positive shift h. Well, okay, it also holds if h is negative. It's just the right formula, but maybe then you have to interpret here this right. It's the interval from x plus h to x. So actually I can also write that this just holds for h in R. Okay, so, and now we can derive approximations for the derivative of v with respect to x from this formula. Okay, actually I just solve for this dv by dx and I get a nice approximation formula from that. So let's start deriving these first order derivative approximations. So if we use here this number 63, so this is our Taylor expansion. Oh, why is it 63? It's 38. That's a typo. Okay, so let's fix this. So our Taylor expansion with n equals 1. So what was n? So n is the order here of our polynomial. If we use this with n equals 1, then we obtain for some xi in x and x plus h that, okay, so from the Taylor expansion, I have v of x plus h is v of x, and then I have a polynomial of order 1. So I have dv by dx times h, and then I have the remainder term, and the remainder term was the n plus oneth derivative. So now the second derivative of v with respect to x at some point, let's call this point xi plus, times h squared half. Okay, so we get here this stuff with the remainder and our polynomial in h. So now just move this guy here. To the other side with a minus, and then divide here this by h. So this here is multiplied with 1 divided by h. Okay. Also move the remainder to the other side. Okay. Then I get here a minus for the remainder. Yeah. It's moved to the other side. I get here a minus for the v of x. It's moved to the other side. And I have divided by h. So it is v of x plus h minus v of x divided by h minus second derivative times h half. So we get here this nice expression for the first order derivative. And now observe that this allows us to derive an approximation, a numerical approximation for dv by dx of x. So note, if h is small and if the second derivative is bounded, say on some interval, then we have that this remainder term here. Yeah, you are right. You're right here in the chat. Why not just make h small? I mean, if xi is continuous in x, yeah, then I can derive that this is bounded. Yeah? So actually, it's not required that I impose it here, that it is bounded. It's sufficient that v is the second derivative is continuous. Okay, so yeah, then the remainder is small. So this red guy here, so you have the question, so we do not know the second derivative. Yeah? It's just that I assume the second derivative is bounded, okay? And then I know that this guy here is small if h is small. So I do not need to know the second derivative. And in that case, I can use this as an approximation formula. So in that case, we can now write, okay, if this is a small error, so if this red part is just a small error, then I have that the first derivative of the function v at the point x is approximately v of x plus h minus v of x divided by h. So the classic finite difference approximation for the derivative. And you know the difference, so your approximation error is just this part here. Yeah, this is your approximation error, yeah, because there is an equal sign here. Okay, so we can just use the Taylor expansion and we can immediately extract a nice numerical approximation method. If you can value the function at two different points, you can use this to approximate the derivative. Of course, you know that what we are here doing, if you have a small graph here, this is just x, this is just x plus h. Then you have some function v. So there is some function v running around here. And now you like to calculate the derivative at this point. So actually this is just the slope of the tangent, which looks like that. But now I use a finite difference, which is the slope of the secant. So which is like that. Okay, and if you make the interval smaller, yeah, then the approximation should get better. Okay, so here it looks as if it's not a very good approximation because we have some larger second order effect. Okay, so you see that the second order term is here introducing the error, yeah, because I'm not linear at this point. So this is the forward finite difference. So the reason that I call it forward is that I use x plus h, yeah, so I actually move into the direction of larger numbers. So if h is positive, we could also do the same with x minus h and move in the other direction. So the backward finite difference is exactly this. So I now consider again my Taylor expansion. My Taylor expansion was number 83. So that guy here. And let's use that again with n equals 1. So we have the expansion up to the first order term plus the remainder as a second order term. But now plug in minus h instead of plus h. So I use here a minus h. This gives me here a minus h here. And then I'm actually dividing by minus h, but dividing by minus h means just I flip the two guys. So I just flip the two guys. Then I get a plus here instead of a minus in front of the remainder term. And of course, I have a possibly different point here, x minus, which is now in the interval from x minus h to x. Yeah, but apart from that, this is exactly the same formula as here in the green box. Okay, I just replace h with a minus h. So we've found another nice expression for the partial derivative dv by dx in terms of function evaluations. Evaluate the function at x, evaluate the function at x minus h, and some remainder term for which we know that the remainder is small if h is small. So from that, we find an alternative way of approximating the partial derivative dv by dx, evaluated at x, can be approximated by v of x minus v of x minus h divided by h. Or if you would like to write it here with an equal sign, so this is equal to plus some error, which is of order h. Okay, so that's the so-called backward finite difference to approximate the partial derivative. So now let's continue, and actually you can do this again and again. Using our Taylor expansion. Sorry for that. Yeah, so let's again use our Taylor expansion, but now with n equals 2. Okay, so if I use it with n equals 2, it's actually here the first line on the slide. So it's v of x plus h is equal to v of x. So move that to the other side. So v of x plus h minus v of x is equal to the first derivative of v times h, the second derivative of v times h squared half, plus a remainder, which is the third derivative at some intermediate point, say here xc plus, times h to the power of 3 divided by 6. Okay, so then use it for h and also minus h. So for minus h, I get the same formula. So v of x minus h minus v of x is equal first derivative multiplied with minus h, second derivative multiplied with minus h squared, but minus h squared is just h squared half, and third derivative, so plus the remainder, third derivative evaluated at some other intermediate point. So this here could be some different point, xi minus, so xi minus is now between x minus h and x, multiplied with minus h to the power of 3, that is minus h to the power of 3, divided by 6. Okay, so now I have two equations. And I'm using actually two different points, x plus h and x minus h, and of course a third point, x, to evaluate the function. So now if I subtract the two equations, so let's say the first one with x plus h and the second one with x minus h. So I'm calculating here the first one minus the second one. Okay, so what do we get? So I have v of x plus h minus v of x minus h. Then here I have minus v of x minus minus v of x, so this cancels. Then I also have here second derivative of v times h squared minus second derivative of v times h squared. So these two guys are the same in both, and we are subtracting, they are also canceling. And here I have dv by dx times h minus dv by dx times minus h. So this is just a 2 times dv by dx. Okay, so if I then divide by 2h, so next step is divide by 2h, I will get here the difference v of x plus h minus v of x minus h that we have there divided by the 2h. Okay, so that's the part of stuff on the left-hand side of the stuff on the top. And on the right-hand side, I have the dv by dx. Okay, and all the remainder terms. So we have all the remainder terms. So I have this guy here minus this guy here. So there is already a minus in the second one. So it's actually the sum of the two, and then just move this guy to the other side. So I have a minus here and these remainder terms here. Okay, and since we divide by the 2h, the h to the power of 3 divided by 6 becomes an h to the power of 2 divided by 12. So now I'm again in the same situation that I have a nice equation. I have a nice equation for the first order derivative. Okay, so now we have remainder terms that involve the third order derivative of the function. But if the third order derivative of the function is continuous on the interval, I can apply here the mean value theorem. And replace actually the average of dV third order derivative by dx to the power of 3 at xi plus and the same term at xi minus by just a single xi in this interval. Okay. So that we get a single remainder term. So now it looks even a bit nicer. So I get the third derivative at an intermediate point xi. So xi is now between x minus h and x plus h times h to the power of 2 divided by 6. So the 12 changes to a 6 because here I have the 1/2 because of the mean value theorem. So now my equation looks even nicer. So I can approximate my partial derivative, first order partial derivative, dv by dx, by this expression here, v evaluated at x plus h minus v evaluated at x minus h divided by 2h, and the error term is just my remainder term here. And this guy is of order h squared if the third derivative is bounded on this interval. Okay, so you see that we are actually pulling out from the Taylor expansion many different approximation formulas, and you can actually continue this. The thing is that if you move to higher orders here with the n, you need more equations to cancel all the remaining terms. Yeah. I need more equations to cancel these guys. So that means I need more points here. Yeah. More points in the evaluation formula. But if you can continue this, you can create higher and higher order approximations for just the first derivative. So let me summarize these three approximations in this definition now. So depending on the point, evaluation point, which we use to approximate the partial derivative, we now call here this guy the forward finite difference approximation of dv by dx. This one here is the so-called backward finite difference approximation. And using the last one where we went to n equals 2 in the Taylor expansion, is then the central or centered finite difference approximation. And you can create more approximations just by using more evaluation points and get better approximation error. So we have a small lemma, yeah? So the lemma is already in this derivation that we have an approximation error of order h for the forward and backward approximation, and we have an approximation error of the order h squared for the central finite difference approximation. A small remark. So this lemma that we know the approximation error from the remainder term of the Taylor expansions. So this lemma suggests to make h as small as possible. Okay, just take a small number in the computer and calculate v of x plus h and v of x or some other point, v of x minus h, and take one of these guys here and calculate an approximation. And maybe we should check this. Okay, so let's do a numerical experiment where we check if this really works. And let's take a very simple function here. Let's take the exponential of x. Well, if you differentiate the exponential of x, then you know this is just exponential of x. And if you evaluate the derivative at x equals 0, then this is just equal to 1. So I already know that the solution should be 1, and now I can check my numerical approximations. So maybe I finish here this slide by just adding also another picture. So let me add here another picture illustrating the three guys. So assume you have here some function. Yeah, so maybe I draw something like that. You like to calculate the derivative here in this point. Then you can go to the point x plus h. And you are actually approximating the derivative here with this secant. Then you can also go to, say, this point here, x minus h, and approximate the derivative with this guy. Or you can use the central finite difference. Maybe I draw that green because it's better. And you have the three approximations here. So this is the forward finite difference. This is the backward. And this guy here is the centered. Finite difference approximation. Okay, so maybe we have a break now. And let's do this nice experiment, which will have a surprise in the next part.